Welcome back, everyone. I'm Jordan Giesecke, and this is The Limiting Factor. In a patent published last week, Tesla revealed they've created a process for a single crystal cathode material made of nickel, cobalt, and aluminum. Today, I'll explain what a single crystal cathode is, walk you through the patent step by step, and how the patent fits with my predictions for Battery Day. Along the way, we'll cover some key pieces of information that I haven't seen discussed elsewhere. Let's get right into it. Most cathode materials are polycrystalline. This means the crystals that make up the cathode are actually many crystals that have fused together. The image on screen is a polycrystalline structure. I've outlined in green one crystal, and you can see that it's fused to other crystals around it at the crystal border, forming a solid mass. If we zoom in to take a closer look at one of those borders, shown by the red line, we can see that the atoms in the crystal structure form perfect rows. The blue arrows show that these rows are pointing in different directions at either side of the crystal border. As a lithium ion battery charges and discharges, lithium ions enter and exit the space between those rows of atoms, which causes individual crystals to expand and contract. This creates stresses at the crystal borders because the crystal structure is aligned in different directions, and therefore expands and contracts in different directions. Over time, the polycrystalline structure tears itself apart at the seams, the crystal disintegrates, and the battery fails. Large single crystals don't run into this problem because the rows of atoms are facing the same direction in every part of the crystal. Even better, with the right coatings and additives, they can last for thousands of cycles. We'll get back to that. Let's take a look at the first page of the patent. The title of the patent is Method for Synthesizing Nickel-Cobalt-Aluminum Electrodes. I'll refer to the nickel-cobalt-aluminum by its abbreviation, NCA. However, the method is what's important here rather than specific materials. When we get deeper into the patent, it will become clear why. The patent was filed by Tesla Motors Canada, and the inventors are listed as Jeff Dahn, Hongyong Li, and Jing Li. Jeff Dahn is located in Canada, and he's Tesla's exclusive research partner. The other inventor names will be familiar if you watched the last video. Hongyong Li was also leading work on a cobalt-free battery with Jing Li, and the work was overseen by Jeff Dahn. As we'll see, this patent leaves room for a cobalt-free battery. In the fourth paragraph of the patent, Tesla describes the standard method for making a polycrystalline NCA material, and the standard method for making a single crystal, NMC, material. NMC stands for nickel, manganese, cobalt. Tesla describes these methods because they will be showing how their method is different, and therefore can be patented. Tesla explains that the standard method for making a battery cathode involves a process called lithiation. Lithiation is the process of making crystals that contain lithium by heating lithium with NCA or NMC materials at specific ratios. For the rest of the patent, when Tesla refers to the ratio of lithium to NCA or NMC, they simply refer to the NCA and NMC as other metals. Tesla states that in the standard lithiation process for NCA, the lithium to other metal ratio is 1.02. In other words, 2% more lithium is used than NCA. The 2% extra is added because some of the lithium burns off when heated. They go on to say that the single crystal NMC process uses a lithium to other metal ratio of 1.2 instead of 1.02, or 20% instead of 2%. In paragraph 5, Tesla lays out the problem that the patent will be solving. High temperatures are needed to create large crystals for a single crystal cathode material. However, high temperatures also cause excess lithium to start reacting with the other metals, which results in low purity material. Reducing the lithium to other metal ratio improves the purity, but then the material doesn't hold much lithium, and the battery wouldn't store much energy. In paragraph 8, Tesla summarizes their solution, which is a two-step process. Step 1 is to start with a mixture that has a low lithium to other metal ratio and heat it at very high temperatures. This allows large crystals to form without excess lithium reacting to the other metals. Step 2 is to reheat the material from step 1. However, this time at lower temperature and with high lithium to other metal ratio. And voila! You now have a cathode material with large single crystals that's high lithium and very pure. In the next paragraph, Tesla explains that there are three variables to get this right in each step: temperature, cooking time, and the ratio of lithium to other metals. They advise that this patent will show the effects of changing those variables. Paragraph 14 states that the process could be used with a range of other materials, such as aluminum, nickel, cobalt, manganese, and magnesium. It's worth noting that these are the same metals that Hongyang Li, Jeff Dahn, and Jing Li tested in their paper outlining a cobalt-free battery. Pay close attention to the last sentence, which states that this process could be applied to a cathode that is strictly nickel, aluminum, and no cobalt. That's the cobalt-free chemistry I targeted in the last video. From here, Tesla begins to explain the visuals included with the patent application. I've modified the images to make it clear what each is describing. Let's walk through the important ones in detail. If you aren't a details person, then feel free to jump straight to the summary. I'll put a timestamp in the comments. Figure 2 shows the results of step 1 of Tesla's two-step process. These are scanning electron microscope images. This is the step where Tesla advised that they would use high temperatures and a low lithium to other metal ratio. The temperature ranges from 850 to 950 Celsius, and the ratio ranges from 0.8 to 0.975 lithium to other metal ratio. As you might recall, step 1 involves high temperatures to grow large crystals and a low lithium to other metal ratio to avoid impurities. Each image you see here is the result of a different combination of temperature and ratio. I've marked 4 of the samples with colored dots. These will show in the top of the next figure. Figure 3 shows the 4 samples that I marked with colored dots in the last slide. Below that, you can see Tesla provides 8 more samples. These samples are the result of step 2 of the process. The 4 selected samples from the last slide were reheated to 735 Celsius at 2 different lithium to other metal ratios. 4 samples at 2 different lithium to other metal ratios results in the 8 additional samples we see here. Again, step 2 involves low temperatures because the crystals don't need to grow any larger, but high lithium to infuse extra lithium into the crystal structure. In the next figure, you'll see these images replaced with charts. At the top of the figure, you'll again see the red, orange, green, and blue marker dots for the step 1 materials. The red and orange boxes will instead be replaced with a 1.01 and 1.02 in red and orange lettering. The 1.01 and 1.02 are the 2 lithium to other metal ratios that were used in step 2. This is figure 5. It took me a few hours to get my head around this. I'll break it down piece by piece. What we're seeing is X-ray diffraction patterns for the 12 samples in the last slide. The first step to understanding this slide is to understand what X-ray diffraction is. When you shine a light through a crystal, you'll often see a band of rainbow caused by the light bouncing through the crystal structure. When an X-ray passes through a crystal, it does something similar. But instead of a rainbow band, you get an X-ray plot. And instead of different colors, you get different intensities of X-rays scattered around the X-ray plot. X-ray diffraction captures those places where the X-rays are intense and spits out graphs like you see here. Each peak you see is a spot where the X-rays are intense. The degrees are the degree of angle from the X-ray source. Over time, scientists have worked out what each peak tells us about the crystal structure. In this set of graphs, Jeff Dahn and his team have chopped up the X-ray diffraction graphs into pieces. They've kept the pieces that show the information that is important, and they've also zoomed in and out where helpful. Let's start at the top half and find out if our crystals have plenty of lithium in them. We're zoomed in very close here, to about 1 degree of the X-ray plot. If you follow the black line up from the red arrows, you'll see a bump on the left side of the peak, like a little tumor. This bump tells scientists that the crystal structure is short on lithium. If you follow the line up from the green arrows, you'll notice that the black line is a little bit further to the right than on the red arrow. You'll also notice that there's a nice smooth curve on the left side of the peak. This tells us that the crystal structure is topped up with lithium. The red and green boxes also indicate how much lithium is in the material. Notice that the peaks in the red boxes are giving us what looks like a middle finger or knuckles. This tells us that the crystal structure is short on lithium. The green boxes show split peaks, which indicates there's plenty of lithium in the crystal structure. With that in mind, we can throw out the samples on the left-hand side of the screen and take a closer look at the samples on the right-hand side of the screen. The ones on the left don't have enough lithium, and the ones on the right do. These graphs are zoomed out and are showing 15 degrees instead of 1 degree. Any peaks on this section of the X-ray plot would indicate impurities. The samples that only went through the first step of the two-step process have a small peak, which I've circled in red, and the materials that went through both steps have smaller peaks, which I've circled in green. The smaller peaks, or no peaks, mean the sample has a low amount of impurities. I've marked the high lithium, low impurity samples on the right-hand side of the screen with a blue box. In the next slide, Dahn and his team apply math to the information in these graphs to find out more about the crystal structure. If you're curious about the math, you can look up the Rietveld method on Wikipedia. These graphs tell us how much nickel is in the lithium layer of the cathode material samples. Understanding why that's important requires some background. The structure of this NCA cathode material is layered in sheets. The sheets are made of nickel, cobalt, and aluminum. In between those sheets is where the lithium ions hang out. Any nickel in the lithium layer takes up space that could be filled with lithium and blocks the lithium from entering and exiting the sheets. This, of course, means that the lower the percentage of nickel in the lithium layer, the better. The bar charts are showing us that the samples that only went through step one have a lot of nickel in the lithium layer. All the samples that were heated a second time have very little nickel in the lithium layer, around 2% or less. I've marked in green the best candidate, which is around 1% nickel in the lithium layer. This is an excellent result, and I expect it would increase the energy density of the material by a small amount, as well as extend battery life. There are two more figures worth discussing, and we'll cover those off in a moment to wrap things up. The rest of the patent document was lots of legal speak to make sure that Tesla has every base covered and states Tesla intends to use this method for a wide range of material combinations. This patent touches on several points made in the last video of my Battery Day series. Let's check how my predictions are going. I advised in the last video that Tesla would move to a 4.3 volt chemistry if the battery management system allows. Here's figure 7 from the patent, which indicates the single crystal cathode is good for 4.3 volts. This would translate into an 8.3% in battery-specific energy at the cell level, which could be applied to the battery pack profit margin or range improvements. One of our viewers pointed out that Tesla's battery management system is capable of 5 volts, and that lead looks promising. A 5-volt limit would make sense because battery chemistries top out at 5 volts. It would be common sense future-proofing. Next, I speculated that Tesla would unveil a million-mile battery. This patent doesn't verify that, but it does show two things that support a million-mile battery. First, figure 8 from the patent shows the phase transitions covered in the last video. For this video, you don't need to know what DQ to DV is, only the size of the number. In this patent, the DQ to DV ratio maxes out at around 400. A chemistry that degrades quickly would have a DQ-DV number in the thousands, as shown in the examples here from the last video. Second, figure 9 from the patent shows how the single crystal cathode performs against polycrystalline cathode materials. Figure A shows that the polycrystalline starts with a higher energy capacity, but then quickly drops to the same capacity as the single crystal. If this chart kept going, the polycrystalline battery would die first. Figure B adjusts for the energy capacity difference and shows that the single crystal clearly degrades more slowly. The titanium coating I suggested wasn't covered in this patent. Briefly, Jeff's team has also been working on a titanium coating for single crystal cathodes that extend battery life even more than single crystal alone. If Tesla and Dalhousie patented the coating as well, then Tesla could fully manufacture the single crystal coated cathode in-house. One new piece of information I didn't cover in my last video is that Jeff Dahn is likely in the process of patenting an alternative to a battery additive called lithium difluorophosphate. Lithium difluorophosphate is the most effective additive on the market for extending battery cycle life. Lithium difluorophosphate is expensive because one company holds the patent, and it's extremely effective at extending battery life. However, Jeff Dahn discovered old research describing how to make sodium difluorophosphate, and he found that it's just as effective as lithium difluorophosphate at extending battery life. I expect Tesla has filed a patent for this, and they'll be making this in-house as well. In the last video, I said that the battery unveiled at Battery Investor Day would be cobalt-free, with 95% nickel and 5% aluminum. This patent clearly states that this process could be used for a cathode that's strictly nickel and aluminum. This might allow for an additional 2.5% increase in specific energy. There's no guarantee that Tesla will use this single crystal patent or cover it at Battery Day. However, this patent definitely improves the likelihood. If this is covered at Battery Day, it will be part of the broader set of improvements we just discussed. Many of these improvements go hand in hand and would result in a specific energy at the cell level of up to 300 watt-hours per kilogram and below $100 per kilowatt-hour at the pack level if there are also pack improvements. If you enjoyed this video, please consider supporting me on Patreon with the link at the end of the video, or snag something off the merch shelf below. I'm also active on Twitter and Reddit. You can find the details of those in the description, and I look forward to hearing from you. A special thanks to Marcus Fink for your generous support of the channel, and all the other patrons listed in the credits. I appreciate all of your support, and thanks for tuning in.